Last week we were looking at what the apostle at the apostle Paul's condemnation of homosexual conduct in Romans chapter 1 verses 24 to 32. And Paul says there that God reveals his wrath against mankind's suppression of the truth about him that is evident in creation. He reveals his wrath against that by handing mankind over to their chosen sin and its consequences. In other words, he opens the door to mankind's headlong plunge into wickedness, and we see the depths to which mankind sinks. Their lust finds expression in perverted sex that is exemplified in homosexual conduct. And I explained last week why Paul's condemnation there cannot be restricted to coercive or exploitative forms of homosexual conduct and cannot be restricted to homosexual conduct in the context of idol worship. Two common attempts to get around what Paul is saying. And if you'll recall, just to remind you, it can't be restricted to exploitative or coercive sex, cannot be restricted to idol worship, because the condemnation is linked to the creation account. Paul alludes to the creation account repeatedly in those very few verses. And condemnation's linked to the creation account where heterosexual union, male and female, was revealed to be God's intention for and design of mankind. The second reason it can't be so restricted is female homosexual conduct did not involve exploitative relationships and did not occur in idol worship in antiquity, but Paul includes that in his condemnation, so clearly that's not the reason. He's not basing it on that, because he includes female homosexual conduct. Thirdly, the desire for homosexual relations by the males is described as mutual or reciprocal, which suggests it's voluntary conduct between willing participants, not coercive, not exploitative. And then finally, having been educated as a Pharisee, Paul was steeped in the uniform Jewish understanding of the Old Testament that all homosexual conduct was sinful, and nothing Paul says in Romans even hints that he rejects that understanding by carving out an exception for certain kinds of homosexual acts. On the contrary, what Paul says in Romans is perfectly consistent with the Jewish understanding, as 1 Corinthians and 1 Timothy confirm, and we'll look at 1 Corinthians and 1 Timothy later here. Now, I also explain why the biblical condemnation of homosexual conduct, this is all review. I like to do that. Okay, I also explain why that biblical condemnation can't be dismissed by the claim that people in the ancient world, they were unaware that some people were internally or constitutionally attracted or oriented toward people of the same sex. And that argument doesn't work, just to remind you, because people in the ancient world were in fact well aware that some people were attracted to those of the same sex and that they engaged in homosexual conduct in fulfillment of that attraction. So they were aware of that. So the assertion and the premise is wrong. Secondly, there's no reason to think the orientation distinction is relevant to the condemnation. That condemnation is rooted in the biological sex of the participants based on God's intention at creation. That's why the creation text is so important. Thirdly, to say that Paul and the other biblical writers were not condemning homosexual conduct by those attracted to the same sex, you know, only those who were attracted to the opposite sex but then engaged in homosexual conduct. You see, that's the idea. Well, Paul's only condemning that. Well, if that's to say that they weren't condemning homosexual conduct by those attracted to the same sex because they didn't know that such a thing existed, which in the first place is false. But even if that were true, God, who inspired them, knew it existed. You see, he knew it existed, so that then raises the question of why God would inspire people to write what the alleged ignorance would cause everyone to misunderstand as a blanket condemnation of all homosexual conduct. You see, you can't strip out God's knowledge. And finally, the morality of a behavior is not determined by the depth of a desire to engage in it or by whether one would prefer not to have the desire. As I pointed out, we all have desires and impulses, things that are deep within us, things that we say, as long as I can remember, this is how I've been, that we want to be rid of. You see, we wish we didn't have, and yet Christ calls us not to yield to those impulses and desires. It doesn't sanctify them because they are deep. All right, now all of that was from last week. You see, so your timing is impeccable. That was just the review. It's just wonderful. All right, all of that was from last week. Now, I want to address one more argument that some people make to avoid Paul's teaching, and then we'll go on and look at what Paul says in 1 Corinthians and in 1 Timothy. Now, some people have tried to get around Paul's teaching, and in fact, that of all other Bible writers, by attributing his negative view of homosexual conduct to the culture's low view of women. You see, that's really what the idea is. That's really where what it's about. You see, the claim is that Paul and the other biblical writers, what they objected to, you see, it's really not the creation violating gender discomplementarity. You see, no, it's not that. It's not that it clashes with the sexual complementarity that God created male and female as sexual counterparts. That's not what it is. It's that this idea that they had such a low view of women, what they couldn't stand was that homosexual conduct has a man acting like a woman or has a woman acting like a man. You see, so it's really a function of their culturally low view of women. That's what it really is about, you see, and that's called the misogyny argument, misogyny being women hating. Okay, this idea. Now, as I already indicated, Paul, of course, he refers back to the creation account. He alludes to it repeatedly in Romans 1. But even beyond that, let me tell you, give you a quote from Robert Gagnon. I think Gagnon just succinctly eviscerates this claim. And he says, first, in Greco-Roman debates about the superiority of male-male love or male-female love. You see, in the Greco-Roman world, they did talk about this. You had people who were saying, no, male-male homosexual love is actually superior to male-female, to heterosexual love. So they had arguments and they had debates. And so Gagnon, who's tuned into this world, he's done a lot of work here, he says, the Greco-Roman debates about the superiority of male-male love or male-female love, in that debate, proponents of male-female love, the heterosexual side, are generally much less misogynistic than the proponents of male-male love. The former tend to have a higher valuation, the heterosexual side, tend to have a higher valuation of women as suitable life mates for men. Misogyny is more a hallmark of advocates for male homosexuality in antiquity than it is of advocates for heterosexuality. And you can see how this just completely guts the argument, right? I mean, since homosexual proponents' lower view of women didn't translate into a ban on homosexual conduct, right? It didn't translate into a ban on homosexual conduct. Why think one's view of women can explain the ban? They had an even lower view of women. And that they didn't ban it. So why think that's the source of it? He goes on and he says, second, even in the Greco-Roman world, absolute nature arguments, the idea of the complementarity of male and female that's obvious from body design, from procreation. You see, in the Greco-Roman world, absolute nature arguments that had little to do with misogyny were sometimes used to reject homosexual behavior. So they weren't going off just on the fact that women are lower class or something. They, in that very environment, were making these nature arguments. Third, since the most intense opposition to homosexual conduct in the ancient Near East and the Greco-Roman Mediterranean basin appeared in ancient Israel, early Judaism, and early Christianity. That's where you had the strongest condemnation of homosexual conduct. He says, advocates of the misogyny theory would have to presuppose that ancient Jews and Christians were the biggest misogynists of their day. And then he says, a patently absurd conclusion. Historically, that's simply false. It's simply false. Fourth, the more pronounced affirmation of women's roles. There was a liberalizing in Christianity. In early Christianity, did not bring with it any lessening in the intensity of opposition to homosexual practice. To the contrary, it only made someone like Paul be more explicit about the implicit opposition to lesbianism in the Old Testament. He's referring to Romans 1. Okay, so that idea, that's just, I just say, what I'm hoping is to arm you about these things, because it's not sufficient to simply just read the Bible. Okay, you read the Bible, and then somebody comes up and tells you or your kid, yeah, that's fine, it's fine. But you know what you don't know? You don't know this. You don't know it's based on misogyny. You don't know this. All of which is nonsense. But if you've never heard that, you see, it puts you out. You go, whoa. You see, and especially in a culture where people are looking so much for a way to get around this so they can be seen as, you know, broad-minded, accepting, our culture's view of loving, which is anything but. Okay, so this is part of what I want you to be able to see and understand some of these things. Okay, talk about 1 Corinthians and 1 Timothy. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul includes among the impenitent sinners who will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, when you read that, that's got to get your attention. He includes among the impenitent sinners who will not inherit the kingdom of God those who in Greek are called malakoi and arsenikoitai. Okay, those are just forms. The lexical form is malakos is the word, and arsenikoites. And they look different when they function differently in sentences, just like run and ran are the same word, but they look different. Okay, but those who are called malakoi and arsenikoitai in 1 Corinthians, he includes them among those who won't inherit the kingdom of God. Or do you not know that unrighteous men will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, there's one of those strange hyphens in there for some reason. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor malakoi, I'll talk about it in a second, nor arsenikoitai, nor thieves, nor greedy persons, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And some of you were these things. Some of you were these things. But you were washed. But you were sanctified. But you were pronounced righteous in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God. You used to be that, but you're no longer because you converted to Christ. But I want you to see this idea grouped with these sins. This list of that impenitent sin, people who don't repent of these things, who live this way, will not inherit the kingdom of God. You have these two. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 8 through 10, he refers to the arsenikoitais. He refers to them in a list of those he describes as lawless and rebellious, godless and sinful, and unholy and irreligious. Here we have 1 Timothy 1, 8 through 10. Now we know the law is good if anyone uses it lawfully, knowing that the law is not laid down for a righteous man, but for the lawless and rebellious, for the godless and sinful, for the unholy and irreligious, for those who kill their father and those who kill their mother, for murderers, fornicators, arsenikoitais, kidnappers, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to the sound teaching according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God with which I was entrusted. Now, the words that in 1 Corinthians 6, 9, you have word malakos and arsenikoites used together. Okay, they're used in conjunction. And when that occurs, when those words are used together, they refer to the active and passive participants in male homosexual conduct. Malakos and arsenikoites, when they're used together, refer to the passive malakos, active arsenikoites, participants in male homosexual conduct. The sodomite and the catamite. The penetrator and the penetrated. That's what those words refer to. Now, when arsenikoites is by itself, it has a broader sense of men who engage in homosexual conduct. It's less specific. When it's coupled with malakos, it takes a more specific cast of the active party versus the passive party. When used alone, males engaging in homosexual conduct. Now, to go through this, what I want to do, when you say, well, how do I know that? Why do I think that? What I want to do is I'm going to walk you through the standard Greek-English lexicons. Okay, these are the things produced by scholars that anybody in the field of biblical studies, if I said these things, would know these lexicons. Then I'm going to show you the standard theological dictionaries. Then I'm going to show you the standard English translations. Then I'm going to take you to the leading scholars, commentators on 1 Corinthians and 1 Timothy, leading English-speaking commentators. And then by the time we're through that, you're going to have a pretty good idea of what these words mean. Okay, and say, well, that guy's just not making this stuff up. Okay, he actually looks like he knows what these words mean. Okay, so we're going to look at that. Now, here's the first one. Now, Thayer's Greek-English Lexicon of the New Testament, it's come out, produced in 1889. It is outdated. It would be one that probably people would not cite because it was produced before the great papyri discoveries, which started in the late 19th century. Okay, but still you will see that later discoveries have not really changed this. And he says, Malakos, effeminate, of a catamite, the passive, the penetrated, of a catamite, a male who submits his body to unnatural lewdness. Arsenikoites, one who lies with a male as with a female, a sodomite, the active person. Then we go to Gingrich's shorter lexicon of the Greek New Testament, second edition, 90 years after Thayer's. Malakos, effeminate, of the passive partner in a same-sex relationship, 1 Corinthians 6:9. Arsenikoites, one who engages in same-sex activity, sodomite, okay, the active one. Pederast. Pederast is a more specific meaning. It is somebody who sodomizes a boy. Okay, so it's a narrower thing, so it would include that, but it's one who engages in same-sex activity. Sodomite, but a pederast would be a subset of that, okay? Now we go here and we say, low and night is Greek-English lexicon of the New Testament. Anybody in biblical studies knows these lexicons, okay? This isn't a secret. Low and night is Greek-English lexicon of the New Testament. Malakos, the passive male partner in homosexual intercourse, homosexual, as in Greek. A number of other languages also have entirely distinct terms for the active and passive roles in homosexual intercourse. Arsenikoites, a male partner in homosexual intercourse. Homosexual, do you see how it can be more general? You see just the male partner in homosexual intercourse? It's when it's coupled with malakos that it clearly functions in this more specific sense of the dominant, the active partner. But it can have broader meanings, and there's some discussion of even when it's isolated, does it have the more specific meaning? All right, he says, it is possible that arsenikoites in certain contexts refers to the active male in homosexual intercourse in contrast to malakos, the passive male. See, so it's just how specific is it? Is it in isolation just general male homosexual conduct? Yes. And when it's coupled with malakos, does it take the more specific sense of the penetrator versus the penetrated? The sodomite versus the catamite. The active versus the passive. Okay? Next one. Now, this is the standard, Freiberg's Analytical Lexicon of the Greek New Testament. This is second edition, 1994. Malakos, especially of a man or boy who submits his body to homosexual lewdness. Catamite, homosexual pervert. 1 Corinthians 6:9. Arsenikoites, an adult male who practices sexual intercourse with another adult male or a boy. Homosexual, sodomite, pederast. Now this is the standard, anybody you ask would tell you, the standard Greek-English lexicon in biblical studies is Bauer, Danker, Art, and Gingrich, the third edition, published in 2000, University of Chicago Press. This is the lexicon. Okay? Doesn't mean the others are bad or anything, but this is the standard lexicon. Costs you $150. All right. Malakos, pertaining to being passive in a same-sex relationship. Effeminate, especially of catamites, of men and boys who are sodomized by other males in such a relationship. Opposite, arsenikoites. Now, 1 Corinthians 6:9. Now, their comment here is very important. This is in the lexicon. And they say, male prostitutes. Okay, male prostitutes, which is how the NRSV translated it, and which is also how the NIV in 1984 translated it, And then they repeated that, the TNIV, which was an update of the NIV, in 2005 translated it. But it says here, you see, 1 Corinthians 6:9, male prostitutes is too narrow a rendering. Because what it means is one who submits and one who is penetrated. It doesn't mean that they take money for it. Well, of course, a male prostitute is a subset of that, but when you define it that way, that's too narrow. Okay? And then it says sexual pervert, as it's translated in the Revised English Bible and also in the RSV, is too broad because there are other forms of sexual perversion than submitting yourself to penetration by a male. Okay, so this is what the standard lexicon says about malakos. Arsenokoites, a male who engages in sexual activity with a person of his own sex. Okay, you see, that's kind of general. It's a male engaging in homosexual conduct. Then they say, regarding its use in 1 Corinthians 6:9, it states, the lexicon, of one who assumes the dominant role in same-sex activity opposite malakos. They go on and comment. Paul's strictures against same-sex activity cannot be satisfactorily explained on the basis of alleged temple prostitution or limited to contract with boys for homoerotic services or service. Okay, so those are the standard lexicons. Now we go to theological dictionaries. New International Dictionary of New Testament Theology has no entry for malakos, but for arsenokoites, it says male homosexual. Pederast. Sodomite. The Exegetical Dictionary of the New Testament, this is the English version, it was translated from German, it's published in 1990. Malakos, the vice catalog of 1 Corinthians 6:9, mentions the malakoi, soft people, weaklings, as reprehensible examples of passive homosexuality. Arsenokoites, referring to a male who engages in sexual activity with men or boys. Then we get, just published last year, the New International Dictionary of New Testament Theology and Exegesis, which is really just a revision of New International Dictionary of New Testament Theology that came out in 76. They changed the title to it, but that's it. It says malakos. And there they quote the NIV. Remember I told you the NIV in 1984 and a TNIV in 2005, they translated malakos as male prostitute. Well, they wised up in 2011, and I'll show you that in a second, okay? But here, this dictionary, this theological dictionary, it quotes the note from the NIV 2011 version explaining that the word refers to passive participant in homosexual acts, and then they comment, this understanding is supported by BDAG, which is the standard Greek lexicon that I already read to you. Arsenokoites. Someone who practices homosexuality, noting that many believe it has the more specific meaning of a man who assumes the dominant role in homosexual activity. And that meaning is brought out in conjunction with malakos. You see, when we have the passive, the catamite, and then we have that with arsenokoites, well, then we have the passive and the active. Alone, it has a more general meaning of men who engage in homosexual conduct. Okay, so there we have that. Now, let me look at some of the... This is in 1 Corinthians 6:9. These are the standard English versions, going back to the King James. Okay? Now, the King James, they were a little more sensitive about how they're going to describe things. You know, the words they're going to use, so they're a little vaguer for sensitivities, okay? Effeminate abusers of themselves with mankind. Now, these are the two words in 1 Corinthians 6:9. Malakos, arsenokoites. 1 Timothy 1:10, you only get arsenokoites. Okay, so here 1 Corinthians 6:9, here are the translations of these standard translations of the two words. You get effeminate, abusers of themselves with mankind in the KJV. American Standard, 1901, effeminate, abusers of themselves with men. Revised Standard, sexual perverts. You see, they combine both of the words. But you remember what Bauer, Dankert, and Gingrich said, sexual perverts is too broad. Right? Why? Because there's other kinds of perversion. You're not getting to it, you know, you've used too broad of a term. New English Bible, one guilty of homosexual perversion. They just combine the two. New American Standard, effeminate, homosexuals. New King James, 1982, homosexuals. And then they put in a footnote, catamites, the penetrated. And then they say sodomites. 1984, male prostitutes, this is the NIV, homosexual offenders. You remember male prostitutes? Bauer, Dankert, and Gingrich said what? That's too specific. That's too narrow of a rendering. Because it's not about prostitution. It's about being the receiving person in a male homosexual relationship. So this was though how the NIV was doing it in 84. They changed in 2011. Okay? Recognizing that the scholarship was there, the data are there, that we need to change this, and they did it. Okay, New Jerusalem Bible, this is an outlier, the self-indulgent, that's just too vague to mean anything. Okay, and then sodomites for the second. Revised English Bible, sexual pervert, they combine both. New Revised Standard in 1989, male prostitutes, again, too narrow, sodomites for the other. New American Standard updated, effeminate, homosexuals. English Standard Version, 2001. You remember the Bauer, Dankert, and Gingrich third edition was 2000. 2001, men who practice homosexuality. Footnote, the two Greek terms translated by this phrase refer to the passive and active partners in consensual homosexual acts. The Christian Standard Bible, published in 2004, any kind of homosexual, so they combine both, and then in the footnote, literally, passive homosexual partners, active homosexual partners. The TNIV in 2005 clings to this male prostitute thing because that's how they translate it in 1984, too narrow, and then the second one they translate homosexual offenders. New English translation in 2005, passive homosexual partners, practicing homosexuals. NIV 2011, here we have the wake up. NIV, they say men who have sex with men. Instead of male prostitutes and homosexual offenders, they combine the two and simply render it men who have sex with men. But then in the footnote they say, the words men who have sex with men translate two Greek words that refer to the passive and active participants in homosexual acts. English Standard Version, 2011, came out in 2004, another version. They're always tweaking these things and trying to stay on top of what is current scholarly thinking. 2011, they repeat, men who practice homosexuality, and then you have the footnote, the two Greek terms translated by this phrase refer to the passive and active partners in consensual homosexual acts. Okay, so there we have the translation. Now, what do the commentators say? Commentators, these are the leading commentators on 1 Corinthians in the English language. Okay? I don't read German. Don't read French. But I know these guys. Okay? And if you ask people to list the leading commentaries, these commentaries would be in them. Okay? F.W. Groshide, let's start in 1953, New International Commentary on the New Testament. Passive and active homosexuals, respectively. C.K. Barrett, the passive and active partners respectively in male homosexual relations. F.F. Bruce, denoting the passive and active roles in homosexual relations respectively. The German, Hans Konzelmann, the sins of sexual immorality are made specific by the introduction of both passive and active homosexuality. Now, Gordon Fee, male prostitute, he continues with this thing too narrow, and he says, in homosexual offender for the second term. Bruce Winter, the participants in male homosexuality. Okay, combining them both. Craig Blomberg, the more passive and more active partners respectively in any male homosexual act. Marion Swords, probably referring to the so-called passive partner in homosexual activity. And male bettors, that's really literally what that word means, arsenokoites. Okay, it comes from male arsenokoite bed. And it comes really, it's thought to be something that they put together because those words are right there in the condemnation of homosexual conduct in Leviticus 20:13. The Greek translation has arsen koite, okay? Arsenis koite, I think. So that's what they think, that's where that word came from. Arsen koites is a male bedder. Okay, but he says here, probably referring to so-called passive partner in homosexual activity and male bedders, perhaps referring to the other partner in the homosexual arrangement. In other words, perhaps having this cast of the more specific active dominant penetrator, instead of generally being a male who engages in homosexual conduct. Okay, Thistleton, perverts, or those involved in pederastic practices, and men who practice sexual relations with men. David Garland, males who are penetrated sexually by males, and males who sexually penetrate males. Alan Johnson, men and boys who take the more passive role in homosexual relations, those who lie with males. J. Joseph Fitzmyer, male persons who practice different kinds of sexual acts with other males. Verlin Verbrugge, I'm not sure how to pronounce his last name. Men who had an effeminate nature and displayed a passive role in sexual relationship, one who lies in a bed with a male. Roy Champ and Brian Rosner, those who willingly play the passive and active roles in homosexual acts. Okay, so just on these words, we've looked at the standard lexicons, we've looked at the theological dictionaries, we've looked at the standard English translations, and we've looked at the leading English commentators. Okay, there's a reason I'm doing that. It is because in the last 40 years, there was an attempt made to create confusion by homosexual activists to say, well, you know, these words are really, you know, it doesn't really go after that. It's only about, you know, somebody who's having sex with a boy or somebody who's involved with a prostitute. It doesn't involve the kind of sex that we're involved in. That's not true. That's not true. And I'm going to give you two quotes, if I have time, two quotes at the end from pro-homosexual scholars who are forced by the evidence to concede the point. Okay, but let's look at 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy, remember this is just now arsenicoites on its own. 1 Corinthians 6, 9, we get malakos in conjunction with arsenicoites. So you get passive and active. Now, arsenicoites alone, taken more generally, men who engage in homosexual conduct. Let's look. King James, them that defile themselves with mankind. American Standard, abusers of themselves with men. Revised Standard, sodomites. New American Standard, homosexuals. New English Bible, perverts. New King James, sodomites. Active, okay. NIV, perverts. New Jerusalem Bible, homosexuals. Revised English, perverts. New Revised Standard, sodomites. New American Standard updated, homosexuals. English Standard, men who practice homosexuality. Christian Standard Bible, homosexuals. TNIV, those practicing homosexuality. New English Translation, practicing homosexuals. NIV 2011, those practicing homosexuality. ESV 2011, men who practice homosexuality. Those are the standard English translations. Commentators on 1 Timothy, leading commentators on 1 Timothy in the English language. J.N.D. Kelly, homosexuals. Ralph Earl, male homosexuals. Gordon Fee, word for male coital homosexuality. George Knight, homosexuals. And he adds, the word does not refer, as some have alleged, only to sex with young boys or to male homosexual prostitutes, but simply to homosexuality itself. John Stott, practicing male homosexuals. I. Howard Marshall, homosexual. Walter Liefeld, male homosexuals. William Mounts, homosexuals. Jerome Quinn and William Wacker, homosexuals, adding, there is little to be said lexically for confining the meaning of arsenicoitai to male prostitutes or call boys. You see, that was the attempt that was made to create, no, you're thinking too broadly. It doesn't mean that. It only means a little subset of male homosexual conduct. All right, that attempt has been beaten back and shown to be false. Okay, that's why I'm going through all this, to show you the strength of it. Towner. Philip Towner. We have Collins, who says active homosexuals. Philip Towner denotes unequivocally the activity of male homosexuality. Andre Kostenberger, those who engage in homosexual acts, adding, it is a broad term that cannot be confined to specific instances of homosexual activity such as male prostitution or pederasty. Okay, now these are guys who are, like I say, these are the leading scholars in English on this book. Now, I tell you that we have a person, the evidence of this is so strong, what I've gone through, that you have pro-homosexual scholars who are driven by this, at least those who will be honest. And I know you can find whatever you want on the internet, but I'm talking about those who are actual scholars who are driven to be honest by the kind of evidence that I'm showing you here. And this is what I'm going to show you next, is from an article titled St. Paul. Now, this article is in the GLBTQ online encyclopedia. And for those not tuned in, that's the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, queer online encyclopedia. Okay, so you have to know that this encyclopedia is fully supportive of the standard homosexual activist positions. Okay, the GLBTQ online encyclopedia is an in-house thing, And they're fully supported of the homosexual agenda. All right, but here is what an article titled St. Paul, written by Eugene Rice, who is the late Shepherd Professor of History Emeritus at Columbia University. And he says, in that online encyclopedia, the meanings of these Greek nouns, malakos and arsenikoites, have been the subject of lively debate, largely provoked by gay authors anxious to show that Paul and the early church had not intended to condemn homosexuality per se as harshly as has been traditionally supposed, but only a degraded type of pederasty associated with prostitution and child abuse. So, I mean, he just calls it out and says, look, all of the noise about these words was generated by the homosexual community trying to shrink down the condemnation. And he just flat out says that. But then he says, recent scholarship has shown conclusively that the traditional meanings assigned to these words stand. So do the traditional translations. The Latin translation, commonly used in the church and therefore known as the Vulgate, and the English King James Version. Paul's malakoi, we can say with certainty, are males, boys, youths, or adults who have consented, either for money or for pleasure, for some perceived advantage or as an act of affectionate generosity, to be penetrated by men. Okay, this is what it means. He then goes on and says of the word arsenikoites, arsenikoitai are therefore men who lie with males. And the Vulgate's masculorum concubitores, or masculorumus, an objective genitive, renders the Greek exactly to mean men who lie with males, men who sleep with males, men who have sex with males. The dependence of Paul's arsenikoitai on the Levitical arsenos koitain, male bed, that's from Leviticus 20:13, they occur right together, demonstrates unequivocally its source and confirms his intended meaning. The word was almost certainly coined by Greek-speaking Jews, understood in the context of what we know about role-playing in most ancient same-sex relationships. Malakoi are the receptive parties, and arsenikoitai the inserters in male-male anal intercourse. Okay, I'm not making this stuff up. Okay, this is here, and so when I have people come, it's a struggle to maintain patience. Okay, because this is clear, and it's one thing to say, listen, all right, I don't care what the Bible says. All right, that's another question. But what we're talking about is the attempt to push into God's church something that God says is absolutely wrong. And the church cannot let it happen. Okay? This is going on in the world. I don't know if you pay attention to this. All right, well, let me, I got a couple minutes and I can cram a lot in a couple minutes. So, here's how you see it. The words, here's what William Loder says. He's another pro-homosexual scholar. He says, you know, very much promotes this, thinks this is how it ought to be. But he has to admit, William Loder says, on balance then, Paul probably uses the two terms, malakoi and arsenikoitai, in 1 Corinthians 6:9, with reference to men who engage in same-sex behavior. With the first referring to the willing passive partner, whether by private consent or as a male prostitute. See, it doesn't matter. That's not the key thing. It's by, he says here, with the first referring to the willing passive partner, whether by private consent or as a male prostitute, those who submit to sexual penetration by other men. And the second referring to those who engage in sexual penetration of other men, which would have a broader reference and include but not be limited to exploitation also by force. So if you're doing it by force or coercively or through an exploitative relationship, you're still penetrating, so you're still within this meaning, but the word is broader than that meaning, right? So that's important to see. Now, with that, I don't know that I'll have time to say this, but let me give you this. Here's how it looks now when we plug in the words, when we plug in the meanings. See, before I just gave you malakoi and arsenikoitai. All right, it says, or do you not know that unrighteous men will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor passive participants in male homosexual conduct, no hyphen, nor active participants in male homosexual intercourse, no hyphen, nor thieves, nor greedy persons, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And some of you were these things. Before Christ called you and transformed you and changed you, you were engaging in these kinds of things, but no more. Why? He said, but you were washed. You were sanctified. But you were pronounced righteous in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the spirit of, and I see I've cut that off. And in the spirit of God, and I don't remember exactly how it goes, but I can't see it. And I don't think I wrote it down here, which I normally do, but I didn't. All right, 1 Timothy 1:8-10, did I cut this off too? It says, now we know the law is good if anyone uses it lawfully, knowing that the law is not laid down for a righteous man, but for the lawless and the rebellious, for the godless and sinful, for the unholy and irreligious, for those who kill their father and those who kill their mothers, for murderers, fornicators, men who engage in homosexual conduct. Now this is serious. And you're not helping people. You see, you're not helping people by pretending that it's okay, by pretending that God's down with it. You're doing a tremendous disservice to the people, and you're doing it, I suggest, out of a selfish motivation that you're just afraid that they won't think highly of you. And I say, that's no way to love people. That's no way to love people. All right, kidnappers, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to the sound teaching according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God with which I was entrusted. Now, what I want to do, we'll start next week. What I want to do, I want to look at the early church's view. You remember, we looked at the Old Testament, went through that, and said, okay, that looks clear. Well, how did the Jews understand it? Before, during, and after the first century. Was there some question about the understanding that seems clear? And the answer was no. Well, then we say, okay, so we have the Old Testament. We have extra-biblical writings of Jews before, during, and after the first century. Then we look at the New Testament. And we see the New Testament very clearly condemns homosexual conduct. Well, now what I want to look at is say, What does the early church say? One would expect, if we're tracking this correctly, that the early church would be unanimous in its condemnation of homosexual. I'm talking post-apostolic, early Christian writers. How did they see it? What did they say? I want to go through and show you that, yes, in fact, unanimously understood homosexual conduct sinful. Okay, that pretty much does it. And then I want to look at another argument they make by trying to analogize it to slavery, and we'll finish next week, Lord willing. Thank you.